class last week. There was a woman here, and we just would, like, on behalf of ESLP, I would like to sincerely apologize to anyone who felt uncomfortable during our last Monday night. And, you know, we try to allow our class to be open to the public so that we can have a broader outreach about the important topics that we're all discussing during this class. However, we haven't had to deal with such inappropriate rude behavior before, and so we weren't prepared for that occurrence last week. We have discussed within our meeting spaces possible steps on how to handle this type of behavior in the future, and along with this, we would like it if anyone would like to further discuss what happened and how we may support you, please don't hesitate to contact us. Yeah, sorry about that again. Now on a brighter note, I get to introduce our speakers of tonight, Unique Dance and Aaron Luxor, over here. So they're Indian voices of color, and their mission is to spread awareness on the connections of oppression that connects animal agriculture and people of color. From health epidemics to environmental racism, the links between our communities and those of non-human animals cannot be ignored. A plight of millions of sentient beings is intimately connected to our own. Unfortunately, mainstream veganism is severely disconnected from most POC, as we see very few of our own faces reflected in the movement. This white veganism is also too often non-intersectional, and they see that issues ranging from income inequality to food access are ignored. Problematic connections of racism to speciesism runs rampant without enough critical thought put into these comparisons. Tired of seeing how this problematic veganism turns so many people away, we strive to provide a space like culture, race, income, and ethics together under the solidarity of social justice. So here you can meet Aaron from Be Voice of Color.
Hello.
All right. So I know that she accidentally mispronounced my name, so I will reintroduce myself. I am Aaron Luxor, Luxor, the fruit of born veganism in the flesh, solar power of Lux, and I'm really excited to be here with you all today. Unique and I have been doing this for quite some time, and it feels really special to be here at this campus and talking with you all. We got our first opportunity to really connect with everyone, with a lot of people. Last year when we went to Sprawl, we got an opportunity from the Sierra Club. And that kind of just spiraled everything. We met Maxine, and she was able to communicate what we do to the other folks here that helped get us here today. So we're really thankful for Maxine and all of our aid and other folks that have done what they have done to make us be right here. I'm coming down from Compton, California. He's coming down from Santa Barbara. So yeah, I'm really excited.
And Aaron Poole said it all. You know, I'm over Berkeley. I'm in Santa Barbara, majoring in environmental studies, but an emphasis in food waste. So I'm really passionate about food justice, environmental justice, and we're talking about our journey that led us to like veganism and kind of what that means and how that looks like and the work that we do. And we also want to be more of a conversation, not just us up here like lecturing at y'all. You know, we're not like professors, we're students too, and we're all young people here who are like trying to make a difference. So we want to be like, y'all can ask questions, like make comments, and like don't act like we're really cool being approached and being talked to as we're going through the a little conversation. So
don't be afraid. Ask questions. I mean, that's ultimately why we're here, because we want to connect with people. And that's pretty much the basis of why we created Vegan Voices of Color, because mainstream animal rights movement is failing to connect with people in a way that is going to evolve the vegan movement and advance animal liberation. So that's what we're here for. Ask questions if you're confused about the term, anything. We have answers. This year I'll be celebrating 8 years of veganism. I'm 22 years old. My journey started much further back, and 2 years prior to veganism I was a vegetarian. And we're going to get into all of that and talk a little bit about both of our journeys. I'll let you start by sharing her journey first.
Yes, like I said, I like studying food waste, which like goes like the cultural, traditional, political, and socioeconomic kind of connections between foods and people and communities. So one thing I think is always important to talk about, like our history with food and like where we grew up at and how that affects what we eat now and kind of how that impacts us as, you know, people with different like ethnicities, nationalities, and backgrounds. So I mean, personally, like unlike Aaron, I was kind of born and raised in Compton, California. So overall, it's like a low-income city. I think you all heard of it before. Probably seen the movies too. But so I grew up in a kind of mostly single-parent household. My dad was kind of there, kind of not there. But my mom was a secretary at elementary school for most of my childhood. I had three other siblings, two brothers and one sister. And food was kind of always an issue growing up, definitely. We didn't eat too healthily. That had a lot to do with kind of food choices available. Like, the kind of alternative food movement wasn't really that big back then, I think we all know, at least on this fight Compton. So we didn't have like organic food and non-GMO and fair trade and all that. So processed foods were kind of very, very much pushed and very much accepted not be too bad at that time. So growing up, I was really addicted to sugar growing up. And I love meat and dairy, and I was always sick. Like always, I'm going to the doctor every month about allergies and just being sick, having difficulty breathing. And they were always saying, well, here, you know, take these pills or take this, you know, go see the specialist. And we didn't find out what was wrong until I got to about, I think, high school. And one doctor finally said, well, maybe you're allergic to dairy. And I was like, what? That doesn't make any sense. Like, what's wrong with dairy? But I didn't even put that out in college when I became vegan. So I was suffering from that all the time, you know, okay, nothing's wrong with dairy, whatever. But even prior to that, I was going on a lot of people with health issues, like a lot of aunts and uncles like diabetes, chronic limited weight diet. I never really made a connection until I got to high school and started researching more. But it's already a lot of our communities being very sick and kind of people not exactly making a connection to how important it is to what we. So food was always like a kind of a background thought. I knew it was an issue because my mom a lot of times was on EBT and food stamps because she worked, you know, she worked a lot. She still couldn't afford to like pay the rent and pay the bills and still afford to get us food. So we did go out and urban a lot. And we also had to go to church donations sometimes to get free food, do around like family and friends. So food security was part of the issue growing up. And as I'm so passionate about it now is that I don't think anybody's going to struggle, you know, being able to like afford to feed their kids or themselves. When we have like an abundance of food, of course, like in this country and then globally. So by the time I got to high school, I was, you know, meat, dairy, loved it, sugar, processed foods, I didn't really care. And then I work with Aaron now, so maybe you tell a story and tell how we kind of met and how it all started to change. And how I started to really think critically about food, and how I started to take animal rights, environmental justice, and climate justice.
Right. So my story and how it started at like really, really young, because one of the things that my family would emphasize back when I was really, really young is to pay attention to your teacher. So I really took that to a literal sense. I paid attention to my teacher all the time. I paid attention to where they walked, what the car they drove, how their lunches looked. It just, our teachers, especially elementary teachers, they play such an important role in our lives when we're younger because they are the people we're spending every single day with and they're influencing us. So it all started about like third grade. I was paying attention to my third grade teacher, Mr. Sullivan, and I was overweight. I had a really overweight childhood, and I had breathing problems. I was asthmatic, and I remember one day, I would always pay attention to what he was eating, but his lunches were always so colorful and pretty and vibrant, and I realized it was something different about what he was eating and mine, and the way I was eating, like, especially in the cafeterias, what they serve us, and we'll definitely get into that part right there in a little bit. But I noticed what Mr. Sullivan was eating, and I asked him, like, you know, it was always some fruits and vegetables, and just so colorful, and the lunch tray was pretty. So I asked him, like, well, why do you eat this way? And his response to me, and I'm at third grade, I think you're about, like, 8 or 9 years old, he goes, well, I eat this way because I don't want to hurt anyone. And it didn't make sense to me. I'm like, me, don't hurt me. And so he explained to me that in order to eat meat, you have to hurt an animal. And then it just started to click. You don't really realize when you're growing up that you sit on this carpet, this colorful pretty carpet with the alphabet strewn across the front of the classroom, A, B, C, D, you sit with your classmates and they're like, A for apple, B for ball, C for cow, P for pig. You don't realize that these animals that we just talk about loving, or we set our outfits and set these animals in, you don't realize that that was your bacon that morning. You don't realize that that was your sausage that morning. And those foods were a part of my everyday life. I woke up every morning to 6 pieces of bacon, sausage, and just all these animal foods every single day. And my favorite snack was like Slim Jim. I was eating so many animal products, but the thing is my mom, she was buying me all these foods because she wanted to make me happy. Eating made me happy. And those were the foods that made me happy. So she constantly kept me with them. She just wanted to make me happy. She grew up not having, not getting everything that she wanted. And so when I wanted food, she did not deny me at all. So if I wanted the whole pack of bacon, the whole pack of bacon was mine. And so once Mr. Sullivan had told me that, that was the first time the connection was made. And I went home that day, and I remember going back to my family, and I declared my vegetarianism. I'm like, Mom, I'm vegetarian now. And my family's always been supportive, so she's just like, okay, whatever you say, you know, we'll see how long that lasts. And I was really, really serious about it. I was vegetarian for about a week. I spent the night over at an uncle's house, and he bamboozled me into eating meat again. He put some meat inside of some beans, and I remember my cousin leaning over to me after I ate the meal, and he goes, there was meat inside the beans. And I was so hurt because I was like very passionate about this, and aside from the passion I felt about just doing something new and replicating what my number one influence at that time, my third grade teacher, was doing, I felt ashamed because the connection, the seed was planted. The moment he told me that someone had to be hurt in order for me to eat those foods that I was enjoying up until that point, I started to eat food in a different way. So there was nothing I could do. I'm 8 years old, I ate meat again, and it was kind of like, well, I ate again, it just is what it is. And from about 8 to 12 years old, I ate meat with a different conscience. The red on the chicken bone was not just like red on the chicken bone, as my mom would describe it or something. Like I identified it, like that is dried blood, you know, but I still ate food. But it was like a totally different conscience that I had about my eating experience. And so, like I said, this time I'm still really overweight, and there was this channel, which sadly no longer exists, Planet Green. It was like an extension of the Discovery Channel Network. And I remember at that time they had like reality TV shows, but it wasn't like junk reality TV shows. It was like reality TV shows that you could really learn from. It was like Ed Begley and his wife, and they were trying to be like the most eco-conscious people that they could possibly be. And then in between the commercials, they would give you so much information about how to save the environment and how to save water and do all these type of things. So at this time, my consciousness was really, really shit because Planet Green was my channel. And so that was about 7th, 8th grade. I started already talking about wanting to do an environmental club on campus because I'm learning so much about the environment, how I can save it. And I wanted my peers to understand these things that I was learning. So I'm talking to my teacher in 8th grade, Ms. Smith, like, I want to start a club. But she's like, you know, it's 8th grade already, you're about to graduate, you know, just go forward. And so I did. But like I said, I became vegetarian in 7th grade. and I was eating differently. I felt good that I wasn't eating animals anymore. But what happened was I doubled, probably tripled my consumption of dairy products. And you know, for me, my whole journey started based on my weight. And it made me, once I started gaining more, I'm like, what is going on with me? Like, you know, I'm not eating any animals, what's happening? So I'm gaining so much weight and I felt so uncomfortable with my health. I had very serious breathing problems. I mean, I remember putting my seatbelt on and I'll remember this moment. I'm putting my seatbelt on and I was having a like breathing, I was forced breathing, I was double breathing. And I remember I was doing this for like some time. But this particular time inside the car, my cousin Janae, she was sitting on in the driver's seat, and she's like looking over at me. She's like, "Pop, are you okay?" Because she sees me like going like trying to get my breath. So fast forward, eighth grade goes by, in ninth grade I'm a vegetarian. We always tell the story. The way we met is so poetic. We met on a ninth grade field trip, and we were going to a botanical garden. So we're here in this botanical garden, and I was new to the school. I started going to Dominguez High School in Compton, California, halfway through the year. I spent a semester at a school in Long Beach called Cabrillo, and then at that time, I was still vegetarian. And then I went over to Dominguez and I met Nini. And so we met at the botanical garden, and when it was lunchtime, that's when we all kind of came together to eat. And you know, she heard me talking about like, oh, I can eat this because I'm vegetarian. And from that moment forward, we became friends. We went on to become best friends. And we had a conversation about vegetarianism right then and there that day. And I explained to her why I went vegetarian. I explained to her things that I was learning from Planet Green, and she was the only person I'd come across that was my age that had any type of environmental awareness. So it instantly was like, whoa, she knows the things I know. I mean, I spend all of my weekends watching Planet Green channels, consuming all this knowledge, and finally I've met someone here in Compton that is knowing what I'm knowing. So we became friends, and that's just how it all began. Like I said, it was already like halfway through the year of freshman year, and we decided that summer that we'd start a club. So we started the Asian Club in our 10th grade year, and that is what really made everything take off, because we were dedicated to not only creating this club. I mean, I had created several clubs on campus. I had created the Dominguez Modeling Club because I wanted to raise self-esteem on campus. And then the Green Teen Education Club because I wanted to talk to my peers about the things that I had learned from Planet Green, from Ed Bailey, from just reading and doing research. And Unique wanted to do the same thing. So we went full force with it, starting our 10th grade year. And what that did was it made us consistently learn about environmental issues. We continue to learn about what's happening with our planet, why is it happening. We were doing research because if we were going to be presidents of this club, we had to make sure that we went back to the club with information that was solid, and we wanted to communicate to our peers what we just learned. That's when we came across the information that animal agriculture contributed 51% of greenhouse gases annually. And it really struck a nerve because it was like, well, you know, we're vegetarian here and we're talking about the environment and we're eating lots of cheese and hot Cheetos. I mean, like I said, when we were vegetarian, it was just like palate on, you know? So it was the hot Cheetos, the double grilled cheese sandwiches. We were just really loading it in, but we felt like we were doing something better. We felt like we weren't contributing to any harm to anyone, and we were doing something better for the environment. So once we learned that back, doing our research to educate more people, that's when we knew that we had to make a change. And soon thereafter, I went vegan, from that moment forward. But I wouldn't call it necessarily veganism. It was more so a plant-based diet. I was literally a walking hypocrite. I was a walking hypocrisy. Just a straight-up walking paradox. To give you an idea of who I was, I had a beautiful vegan lunch, something similar to Mr. Sullivan, and I was walking around campus with a chinchilla fur around my neck. It just was a disconnect. I hadn't made the connection yet, but yet I was invested into making these changes, one for myself because I was overweight and I wanted to be healthier, and then two because I had to learn about the environment. But it had nothing to do at all with the animals. We didn't, there was a time, I know we're pretty ashamed of this, but we really would talk, like when we get into conversations and people would challenge us about like why we were doing what we did, we would say, oh, well, you know, we started doing this for the environment. And we were talking like this, and that's when we had to eventually start looking at people's criticisms of why we were doing what we were doing. And we thought deeper about, you know, how could we live this way, and how can we speak about this if we're not being true to what we are talking about? And Unique had already was talking to me about going vegan, and I had to jump right into it. A year after, she got into it, and that's really how our vegan journey started.
Yeah, and look back on like, it took me a while too, because even when we first met at on that field trip, I was eating like a beef burger, and like when it came up to me to talk about vegetarianism, I was really, really annoyed. I was like, I hate vegetarians, vegans, like they're so annoying. Like I thought there was nothing wrong whatsoever with eating meat or dairy. I'm like, if we're made to eat meat and dairy, you know, it's natural, it's, you know, it's really cool. So I was like, oh my gosh, here's this dude, you know, talk to me while I'm eating my burger and fries, whatever, but it's kind of cool. So yeah, talk to him some more. I'm passionate about the environment, so let's go from here. And I like, grew up watching Planet Green. Like I grew up watching Captain Planet. So from there, I kind of like started thinking more about the environment and environmental issues. And growing up in Compton, you know, like we have like the LA River running through a lot of parts. It's not really a river. It's like a concrete kind of waterway. It's a lot of trash and stuff down there. We kind of look, yes.
So much trash.
So looking around, it's always been like, oh, it's, why aren't there trash here? Why aren't there any green spaces? You know, why do we have like these factories and stuff, you know, in our city that pollute the air? Why there's so many food waste? So kind of watching Captain Planet, I got really passionate on environmental issues. So by the time we got to high school and we started our environmental club, I started thinking really critically about the system that we're under and what it means to be environmentalist and what does change look like. So when I read a big article on animal agriculture and how it affects the environment. And now they are becoming like, a vegetarian. He hasn't talked to me about it for a while, but I was like, I'll do meatless Mondays, I'll do meatless 2 times a week, whatever, but I'm not going vegetarian, let alone vegan. But luckily, that did change reading that article and getting more educated, and I was like, wow, this is so important, and I have a means to like make a dietary change that can have like, a huge impact. So what's my excuse like really not to do it?
Yeah, so we, like I said, we started that club, and that's really what skyrocketed us into becoming the people who we are today. And Vegan Voices of Color feels like an extension of what we were doing in high school. We wanted to connect with our peers then. We wanted to teach them about what we were learning. And so now we're just doing that on a larger platform. We want to connect with our peers, we want to connect with our community, and we want to connect with people of color and all marginalized people. And we want to get them to understand how veganism actually relates to our oppression. And we felt like that is very necessary because the mainstream animal rights movement fails to connect those dots for any marginalized person. And we knew that, you know, it always felt weird. I remember getting onto Facebook groups and all the forums and stuff, and I would see things like, because this is when now the ethics started to kick in. I started to learn about veganism from an ethical standpoint. My first time really getting into the ethics of veganism, I remember watching a Gary Yourofsky video, you know, best speech ever. And of course, I'm like, whoa, he's it, you know. You know, don't care about this, we don't need to be worried about what's going on with us. It's all about the animals. Like, they're going through something way worse than what we're going through. And I instantly got into that style of veganism. So there's a term that we always use called white veganism, right? And it's important to note that although it's very much recognized through white people, white veganism can be exercised also as a person of color. Because my influence at that time, after watching the Gary Urofsky, I became him. I was talking and advocating veganism the same way he was advocating veganism. And it wasn't doing anything. And I was in the groups, and I was starting to see things like comparisons of animal slavery to black slavery. There were images of white people would post these, the white vegans would post these photos to like share on Facebook, and it would have like a black person hanging, and on the right side they have like a cow hanging. And I was just like, and it would say, what's the difference? And it just was like, whoa, this kind of doesn't feel comfortable for me, you know? Like, if I have to feel this way I feel to advocate this lifestyle, it put me in a very weird place. And for a lot of people of color who had came across access to veganism and started learning about veganism, this was the route, because the mainstream vegan movement, or at least what's advertised, is very white. I remember people would associate veganism all the time when I would explain to them that I was eating vegan after I had made the decision to let go of dairy. When I learned about the environment, people would say, oh, you know, that's a white people's diet. And I had to start thinking critically, why do they think that this is a white person's diet? And what is white about not wanting to eat stuff? So I had realized this is because of the way mainstream veganism was advocating animal liberation. It was really separating, it was really being divisive to all marginalized people, and really making us, it was telling us to, it was erasing our struggles, it was erasing our experiences, and telling us that we should not be caring about what our lineage has experienced, what our experiences are on a daily basis, and that we should focus on other animals' lives. Now, when I think back about everything critically, I mean, when you're coming from a place of privilege where you don't have to necessarily worry much about, you know, a police or someone, something happened to you inside your community, or every time a police is going by, your heart is double skipping, you could have a one-sided view of oppression because you're not oppressed. So you could, it's very easy for someone to say, no, you need to see what the animals are going through because they're not experiencing oppression themselves. So I started making a serious connection about something is going wrong here, something isn't right. And I know that what is going right is the change that I made, because I feel way better, my health is amazing, but my community didn't have access to any of these foods. I mean, we had to drive 13 miles. My mom, I grew up in a low-income family, single parent, government assistance, and when I was making the switches, like I said, my mom has been number one for anything I wanted to do since the start. When I told her when I was 8 years old, I'm vegetarian, she was all for it. When I told her I was going vegan, she was all for it. And at that time, I had a conception about veganism being, oh, I have to get organic food. If it's not organic, then I can't eat it. And we have to go to Whole Foods and all this. And my mom was driving 13 miles all the way to Whole Foods in El Segundo. And we would, she would spend literally, I guess like the food stamps, like $344 a month or something like that. She spent the majority of that just on my foster so much. But she was making all these sacrifices for me. And it just was something wrong with me. Everything just felt so wrong because I was learning from the advocacy that I was being taught from. So I was thinking I had to be this way if I was going to start talking about animal ethics. I had to project veganism that way. So in a way, I was exercising white veganism as a person of color. And so that's something I definitely want everyone to understand here. The term has, though it does have a lot to do with white people who advocate veganism that way, you can be a person of color, advocate. If you've been taught veganism that way, you advocate veganism that way. And so it was actually Unique who introduced the term intersectionality to me. And that's when things really, really changed for me, because it all made sense. All the emotions I felt, it became that. I knew I felt weird about the things I was seeing on Facebook, but I was kind of just like, okay, should I be also saying this if I'm trying to get other people to understand why they should be vegan and why they need to understand that the environment is in peril because of animal-based diet? Should I also be sharing these type of images? But I could never bring myself to it because it did not feel right for me to do it. I knew that I would just not be, I wouldn't connect to anyone that way. I knew that the people who were on my timeline would look at me and they'd be like, what is going on? So I never shared it, I never felt comfortable, and I never talked about it with anyone because I didn't have anyone to talk to. The spaces that were advocating this way, they were all very white. Usually I was the only person of color in that group, or even when we would attend like vegan meetups and stuff like that, I'd be the only black person there. And so it really wasn't a way that I could just kind of say, hey, you know, it feels kind of weird when I see things like a cow hanging and a black person hanging, and I'm supposed to tell people, if you want to, you need to make a connection and you need to stop eating animals, because what you experience is just as bad as what's going on right now. I could never advocate that. So then Unique came to me and she checked me on. She told me that this about intersectionality.
Yeah, so when I became vegan in college, when I was in the second year, I took a class on climate justice and we watched Cowspiracy. So before we watched Cowspiracy, you know, learning all the ins and outs of how climate change impacted communities all over the globe, like disproportionately. How, you know, island nations are going underwater, how, you know, people across the global south, and even here, like in a lot of Western nations who are more marginalized are being affected and are going to be hit the hardest. So after learning all that, to Cowspiracy, I was like, okay, well, I need to give up dairy because if it's one of the leading causes, you know, of climate change, environmental destruction, then I don't want to like be a part of that if I have a choice, and I did have a choice, so I want to be in. And I started getting more into it, and I was like, going on Facebook groups, looking online. And a lot of what I noticed was that a lot of it was, I thought it would be great. Like, I think it's going to be, you know, the best, whatever, you know, like, in it for the animals and the environment or whatever. They're like, so awesome. They're going to be like, you're so understanding. But it's kind of the opposite. Like, a lot of my background are really, really racist. And it was very easy to see that very soon after I kind of got into it. And again, like I was saying, you know, like, a lot of it was kind of based on, you know, comparing, like, oh, the Holocaust, you know, is now when we're doing animals, you know, or, oh, I control tears, like, we need to, like, we need to focus on when we're doing animals. It is not that we can't say that what we're doing to animals is really, really messed up, and that it's, we're doing atrocities, you know, it is mass killings, and a lot of it is actually the torture with how they, like, how animals are raised and treated, you know, to be killed. But the ways in which, you know, these people were kind of talking about it, when they didn't have a personal connection to that history and that trauma, and they weren't intersectional about it, like, they were kind of ignoring that, people were still going through that today, and not some people were saying, you know, like, hey, you know, my grandpa survived the Holocaust, you know, and the way that you didn't do any blatant comparison without being, like, critical thought or critical kind of analysis is just not right. Was kind of a big thing. A lot of people I know online, people of color and stuff, they saw that, they're like, you know, you're vegan, you know, you think animals are better than humans, you don't care about human issues, you know, you don't care that I'm poor, that I'm this and that I'm like struggling, and all you care about is, you know, animals, and so that was a big misconception. I'm like, actually, no, you know, I got into veganism and vegetarianism because I'm coming from a place of wanting to advocate for my communities. For environmental justice, for food justice, and then I started learning more about animal rights after that, and connecting to genome intersectionality, you know, that the way that we're harming animals, other animals, how it's impacting us, and that once I kind of been being for a while and I started to say, okay, well, wow, I don't need meat or dairy to survive. I'm like the healthiest I've ever been. And you know, I'm not consuming animal products. I started to really think, well, why do we have meat and dairy 3 times a day, every single day? Like, what's that all about? What is that? What's the thought process into that? Why don't we question it? And when we're growing up or in college or whatever. So going to that, I started to think more about, well, if it's not necessary to categorize animals, you know, what does that mean for making that choice to do so when you don't have to do it? And what does it mean that that choice is also really devastating the environment and devastating a lot of communities all over the globe? So I started to connect it to, you know, a lot of other ones that I was working with. Again, food justice, environmental justice, and it just went straight back to animal rights. And that's how I really started getting into, okay, you know, I'm vegan, you know, not just for the environment, I'm not just for my health, but I'm vegan for kind of what variety was. Vegan was originally created. Veganism, you know, to really advocate for other animals and to really get critical about what's our relationship to the rest of the living beings on the planet.
Yeah, so, and you know, like I said, the movement had no indication that people of color just were very underrepresented in the vegan movement altogether. I had no knowledge about Dick Gregory, Move 9, or any other historical movement that was actually advocates for animal liberation before Donald Watson in 1983 even coined the term veganism. And so as I evolved and I started to learn more, I started to learn that actually people of color have been very much involved in animal rights for a very, very long time. And going deeper into my research and just learning as much as I possibly can, I started to realize that these people, the Move 9 and Dick Gregory, they were speaking about veganism as a way to heal and empower the Black community. And that was striking to me because it was a complete contrast to the veganism that I was originally exposed to. Veganism that was very, a way of advocating veganism that was so toxic that I didn't even feel comfortable sharing or speaking the things that I was hearing. I internalized it, kind of felt weird, but now I've touched bases on something that felt something so concrete. And the question melts down to how can we make that connection for other people? And it, the same way we wanted to connect our peers to the issues that we were learning about the environment back in high school, we wanted to do that for veganism. And so we started Vegan Voices of Color. And aside from, you know, veganism as a way of empowering communities of color, because our community, these are just observations you realize growing up anyway. Our communities, the way they're set up, is McDonald's, Burger King, Jack in the Box, liquor store, gas station with snacks, pharmacy. And this was always something I realized. I started making this realization earlier on, but especially when I started making this transition and realizing how difficult it was for me to like uphold this organic lifestyle. I had to go so far to get an organic apple, and I was just associating veganism with health and eating organic. And it just was a whole misconception about what veganism is all about because of the way I initially had it advocated to me. But through Vegan Voices of Color and learning much more about intersectionality, I was able to make so many greater connections about why veganism is a must for any oppressed people. I started to make connections about how the vagina has been practically turned into a money-making machine for our capitalist society that we live in. They've literally turned the cow's reproductive system into a way of just making profit. So, me, I wanted to make sure that I was being strong in feminism. I wanted to make sure I was being strong in my environmentalism. And so these connections were very, very strong for me because I'm like, wow, I would have never realized how If I'm identifying myself as environmentalist, as a feminist, and I am consuming meat and dairy products, I am actually going against everything that I stand for. It was just, I started making connections about all hypocrisy. And what I realized was the mainstream animal rights movement, they were not discussing any of these things. Yet they were trying to convince us, support animal rights, forget about your problems, and shut up about your problem, because that has nothing to do with nothing, it doesn't matter, and you need to be focused on this. And it was incorrect, it was in doubt. That's what intersectionality did. It put the dot, it connected all the dots, and everything started to make sense. And that's when I really got into making sure that I was advocating veganism from an intersectional standpoint and telling people about how dairy is exploiting the female reproductive system. Because these are connections that people had never made before. Connections that the mainstream animal rights movement was not advocating. And I realized that, you know, there are so many ways that you can advocate veganism without having to discredit or erase anyone's experience. That was so unnecessary to try to help me. Actually, it did nothing. And when I was practicing and advocating veganism from that way, no one was listening to me at all. They didn't care. I was exercising the white people's diet, as a lot of people in my community would tell me. You're just eating, you know, eat your salad or something like that. They would say these type of things. It was not for them. But now that I was able to hit these points and understand and help them understand how our community is set up for us to be the leading in all the health epidemics. Helping make those type of connections is what really got people to start thinking differently. And so that's when I said, okay, we've got to take this to a larger level. And we started writing about it on a blog. We started our blog, and a lot of people have come to us. And matter of fact, Maxine, who is one of the reasons why we're here today, she actually made a transition after we had spoke about intersectional veganism through the Sierra Club. Sierra Club had gave us a fabulous opportunity last year to design an all-vegan menu for 43 people for 8 days inside the San Gabriel Mountains. And that experience was extremely impactful for not only myself, but for all the people that was there, because it wasn't our job to even speak about, I mean, at least mine. So I was just supposed to be a cook inside the kitchen. But they were so connected to the food I was making. Now, that's another point that I kind of forgot to touch on, but food has really been my number one form of advocacy, because I knew that I could not advocate, I did not feel comfortable at all advocating veganism the way I had been advocating veganism to. I couldn't tell someone, like, listen, do you know that there's a Holocaust still going on, and it's with the animals? And you need to understand that your cheeseburger is just as bad as the enslavement of your own people. Like, I could never do that. I would never bring myself to do that. So I use food as my number one platform. And so being able to, because once I started changing my diet, and I was the only person in my family living this way, eating the way I was eating, you learn. It forces you to learn. Once you step out of the drive-thru and you step inside your kitchen and you're like, I'm going to make this work for me, you have to learn to cook for yourself. So I started cooking for myself, started figuring things out, many failures, many successes. I learned what worked. And once I started getting good at it, I'm like, okay, well, let's start sharing food with my friends. Let's start sharing food with my family. And they're like, oh, this tastes good. This tastes good. And I was like, whoa, okay, that's the response that I want. This is the way I'm going to advocate veganism. I want to show people that, hey, this burger, this hamburger that you just ate right now, no one has to lose their life. It's not going to contribute to our current drought. It's not polluting our air, our water, our soil. And you enjoyed it just as much as you would have eating an animal-based product. And so I started advocating food in that manner. And so that's how we got to the Sierra Club, and we designed a menu, a vegan menu, And people really, really vibe with the food. They love the food. And I realized that's what it all comes down to with veganism. People are afraid to sacrifice two things. Three things. Taste, texture, tradition. No one wanted to go from eating food that they have been eating all their lives, food that they have connected to very important events in their lives, holidays, foods that their grandparents would cook. For me, it was always my aunt's macaroni and cheese. Like, there was nothing that was going to make me stop eating my aunt's macaroni and cheese. That was everything. I looked forward to it on every single holiday, and it was just all about that. People didn't want to sacrifice it. They don't want to lose it. No one wants to go from eating food that they enjoyed all their life to having to figure out, okay, so what do I eat today? So I said, okay. And then texture. People didn't want to go immediately from, although I eat 90% fruit diet now, and I feel better than I've ever felt in my entire life. I've never experienced the health that I have today, ever. I feel so amazing. But I like to make sure that I keep the conversation of health and veganism far separate from one another, because while they can be mutual, they are exclusive. Veganism has nothing to do with health. It's your prerogative if you want to eat sweet, spicy Doritos, red vines. I mean, I had to learn eventually in my vegan journey that just because it was vegan, it didn't mean it was healthy. And just because it was healthy doesn't mean that, you know, it has to be made from a plant-based product or an animal-based product. It was like, okay, eat this food and see how it makes you feel. Eat this food, you see how it makes you feel. Which one is working for you? I knew how, and it's funny, I think, because a lot of times people who are not yet vegan, or I like to look at everyone that's transitioning vegans. They'll come and they'll try to tell you, oh man, you don't know what you're missing out on. And it's like, I actually do know what I'm missing out on. These are the foods I've been eating majority of my life. And now I'm eating those same foods made of plants, and I'm still enjoying them. So sharing food really was a way of connecting people. That's the way I did it. And tradition, people don't want to sacrifice tradition. I had to make sure that I showed my family, although they were very supportive of me, I wanted to let them know that it wasn't going to dictate who I was as a person. It wasn't going to make me separate myself from my family. It wasn't going to make me change. Anything that they were eating on the holiday, I made sure that I had that exact same thing, except me for plants. Showing other people that they can still enjoy all the foods and they can still enjoy the experiences that they have enjoyed with their family, their loved ones, that's all people care about, you know? They want to eat good food and they want to still have a good time with everyone that they have always enjoyed traditionally. So, you know, food became my number one form of advocacy as far as veganism is concerned.
Yeah, and I think that was a really cool thing when we started Be Voice of Color, was coming away, able to way to advocate for veganism. That was like making veganism, which of course like most people who have been here and like, oh my god, vegans, like they're so annoying or they're so, you know, problematic or they're so this and that. It was really getting away from that and saying, okay, you know, how do we become vegan, how do we connect to other people, it's really how do we connect to marginalized communities who, you know, we really want to be vegan, because we think of whole foods a lot of times, you know, and just straight animal rights, you know, not about humans or anything, and just, it's really problematic comparisons, you know, and a lot of times, you know, one thing that I don't say, you know, I don't even say that my diet is, like, cruelty-free, because, you know, the farmers who are growing my veggies and grains and stuff, you know, a lot of times, you know, are still undocumented, or still being treated like crap, or not having their rights, basic human rights, kind of dignified or anything. And so, even though addressing that, you know, that within veganism, you know, you need to be really critical of what we're eating still, and see where that comes from, and how that's impacting people and the environment and communities, and have those conversations. And then people know that, and I want to study food ways, because really studying, though, like my mom was talking about, that a biggest mistake becoming vegan for most of us is that, oh, you know, my traditions. You know, my coach, you know, is very meat heavy. It's centered on meat and dairy. You know, that's very important to me and my family. So I don't want to give that up. And I just don't think that your animals, you know, are, I care about animals, but I don't love them that much. I think that we are supposed to eat them. So really combating and really having deep discussion about what does history and culture mean in 2017 when it comes to our current predicament within the environment, and how we're treating other animals, and how we're seeing each other, and really being critical about nothing wrong with changing, you know, cultures and traditions and adapting to newfound knowledge and understandings of who we're serving the planet with. And say, you know, hey, I can still have my soul food and still have it be, and have it be all plant-based. It have to be better for me, the planet, and the animals, of course. And really kind of shifting how veganism is kind of talked about. And I think there's a whole bunch of really amazing intersectional vegans out there who have been doing this work. I think for quite a while, we like the Food Empowerment Project, Black Vegans Rock, and other groups, the Vegan Feminist Network, that really, Rachel Adams, her name, who does a lot of, writing about like the politics of feminism and like the agriculture industry, and how people really start to connect the dots against apart from mainstream veganism, so that we can really start talking about it in a way that's actually productive and is actually considered like people with different histories and realities that that we all face.
Thank you.
Also, like, I want to know how...
You said get up, so you can our outfits?
Yeah.
Thank you.
But, like, also not just your outfits, okay? Just
not... Well, no, thank you. Also, by the way, everything that I'm wearing is completely vegan. These are some Chelsea boots. You can get them at Will's London Vegan. WillsLondonVegan.com is where I got my belt from. I got my shoes from. Shout out to Will's London, send me the new black vegan Chelsea boots if you're seeing this. Yes, but go ahead.
So I don't know what, like, how, do you guys have stuff on campus? How can you involve on campus? Are you guys around?
Well, we were invited here to campus, like I said, from someone that we had met through the beautiful program from the Sierra Club that we got to do in last year, 2016. So that's why we were invited here today. But back in our hometowns, most of my advocacy is on a one-on-one basis, if it's not online, through Vegan Voices of Color. But we do want to create a way for anyone on campus who is interested in advocating veganism from an intersectional standpoint, and educating their peers and their community about why intersectional veganism is important. So the outlet that we're probably going to publish something or write something up or post something onto our website, veganvoicesofcolor.org, about how you can get involved, because like that's what we've been doing since the start. Like I said, Vegan Voices of Color is just an extension of what we've been doing since high school in our Green Team Education Club. We are just trying to connect and teach people, teach our peers, teach our communities about what we were learning. So we do want to provide some resources so that if we aren't on the campus, you are on the campus, you can be that change.
Yeah, and also, like you said, we just started an animal rights group. So there's also a vegan Facebook called Here, like something environment, animal rights, human environment, animal rights, something like that. But before those started this year and last year, I got involved with them on campus by our starting involved like kind of social justice groups on campus, like racial justice groups, food justice groups, environmental groups. And from there, I started saying, hey, can I like host a meeting about like veganism, how connects like different groups? And it's like, yeah, sure, you know. So I will host like workshops and talk to like the members and exec members of the boards and what's about veganism. And they're still like learning about it and like saying, oh, no, I didn't know that, you know. It's really connected to like environmental groups, racial justice groups, and even gender groups. And doing that, and now we actually have an animal rights group on campus at UCSB. And so first, we definitely start with connecting to actual like groups that are already present, and it's definitely people I know, UCSB, Santa Cruz, other UCSB campuses, or like who are vegan or who are not and want to get involved.